Welcome to worship.
This Sunday, Old South Church and First Congregational Church of Reading are joining together to celebrate Epiphany Sunday and the arrival of the Magi.
If your home church is Old South, you are welcome here.
If your home church is First Congregational Church, you're welcome here.
If you're searching for community and belonging today, you're welcome here.
First Congregational Church is an open and affirming congregation of the United Church of Christ, and Old South is a reconciling congregation of the United Methodist Church. What does that mean? It means that no matter who you are, who you love, how you identify, whether you're gay, straight, cis, or trans, you are welcome here.
Whether you're feeling lonely these holidays, maybe need a break from family, or if you're overworked or underemployed, you're welcome here.
No matter where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here.
Today's reading is from Matthew 2, verses 1, 2, and verses 9 through 11. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in the territory of Judea, during the rule of King Herod, Magi came from the east to Jerusalem. They asked, "Where is the newborn King of Jews? We've seen a star in the east, and we've come to honor him." And look, the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stood over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They entered the house and saw the child with Mary, his mother. Falling to their knees, they honored him. Then they opened their treasure chest and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Once upon a time, in the middle of the night, in a very dark sky, a star arose. She was just an ordinary star, and she crept up the dome of the sky. No one paid her much attention. Beneath the night sky, people ate their supper. They tucked their children into bed. They tidied their homes, they fed their animals, and they fell asleep. But the star kept rising. She had an important message. Far away, in another part of the world, a baby had been born. The baby was a promise of love and light for people who felt lonely and afraid. When the star saw the baby, she shone twice as brightly. She shone brighter than every other star. She was so joyful, she wanted to tell everyone what had happened. So she rose above the horizon and she shone her light on the king. The king should know about this wonderful baby. But the king was much too busy with important things. He counted his money and shined his armor. He didn't notice the star. So she rose a little higher and she shone her light on the priests. Surely the priests would want to know about this wonderful promise. But the priests were much too busy with important things. They studied their books and argued about God and swept the temple floor. They didn't notice the star. So she rose a little higher and she shone her light on the rich, important households. The important households could tell all the people about this wonderful love. But the people in the important households were far too busy with important things. They sold crops and bought silks. They threw big dinners and parties. They cleaned their great houses. They didn't notice the star. The star was disappointed. "I wanted to tell everybody about this wonderful baby," she thought. But the king didn't notice, and the priests didn't notice. And the important people in the important households didn't notice. "Everyone is too busy to notice me." Then she thought, "Well, I'll shine anyway. Perhaps no one will see, but I'll shine anyway. I'll shine for the baby. I'll shine for the promise." And she did. She kept shining and she kept rising. Far away, in the middle of the night, under a very dark sky, three wise people watched the sky. They saw the star. When they saw how brightly it shone, they felt warm inside. They were puzzled. "Why is this star shining so brightly?" they asked each other. "This star must be special," they thought. "We should study it," they agreed. They watched the star, watched it move across the sky, and as they watched, they wanted to turn towards it. They wanted to move closer to it. They wanted to know the star better. So they packed up their things and they left their homes. Everywhere they went, they asked the people they met, "What do you know about the star?" But the people all shrugged their shoulders. They hadn't noticed the star. The wise people were discouraged. "We just want to find out what this star is about," they said to each other. "But everyone is too busy to notice it." "Well, we'll keep searching anyway. Perhaps we'll never find the answer, but we'll keep searching anyway," they thought. The star moved across the sky, shining brighter, filled with more joy every night. And every night, the three wise people grew more certain that the star meant something important was happening. One night, the star stopped. The wise people had followed the star to a town on the edge of a great city. It didn't seem to be a special town. There was no festival. There were no parties. There were no crowds of people. Just a little town with houses and shops and people asleep. The wise people were tired. Since the star had stopped, they decided to rest too. They knocked on one door. "We don't have any room, I'm sorry," said the man who lived there. They knocked on another door. "We don't have any room, I'm sorry," said the woman who lived there. The star looked down and noticed the wise people. She knew someone had noticed her message. She was brimming with joy. As the wise people knocked on the third door, they felt warm inside. They noticed the star shining a little brighter. Inside, they found a mother cradling her baby. They found a father gazing at his son. Those people shone as bright as the star. The wise people knew they had found the important thing the star was trying to say. And the star knew someone had seen her shining with such joy. As the wise people doted on the baby and talked with the mother and father and marveled at the promise of love, they remembered how discouraged they had been on their journey. They remembered thinking they might never find the end of their searching. And they were so glad they kept searching anyway. And the star remembered how disappointed she had felt. She thought no one would ever notice her shining. And she was so glad she kept shining anyway. Our time is a time when many people feel lonely and afraid. Perhaps you feel like the star, full of joy and hope and love and promise, but disappointed because no one seems to notice the goodness that you see all around. Perhaps you feel like the wise people, sometimes we call them magi, who are looking for something, but they're discouraged because you don't know exactly what you're looking for and no one else seems to be able to help you. The blessing of Epiphany is the promise that our searching and our shining are enough. If what you have is a light, shining is enough. If what you have are feet for walking, the journey is enough. If what you have is a heart for loving, showing up is enough. Many of you received a gift from the Magi in the mail. We invite you now to open your gift. Inside, you'll find a star word. This one says wonder. Like the star guided the wise people to Bethlehem, even when they didn't know exactly what they were looking for, let this word be a guide for you in the year to come. It might surprise you or inspire you. You might use it in prayer or hold it as a meditation. You might carry it around on your keys or tape it to your bathroom mirror. Open yourself to the gifts this word might bring to you and to your family this year.
Join me in the spirit of prayer. Holy and loving God, you knit us together underneath a galaxy of stars. And although there may not be one brilliant, bright star guiding our path in the sky, we know that star resides in our hearts, that you are the light of the world, that you guide us in each and every step. We pray that you show us the way. We pray that you give us the words to speak upon our lips. We pray that that guiding light be sensed and felt and shown, not only for ourselves, but for each other. Holy One, we come with many prayers for healing, for comfort, for grief and loneliness, prayers for broken bodies and broken hearts. We come with prayers of joy and tender feelings, prayers of celebration and prayers of gratitude. We lift up these prayers to God now in the silence of our hearts.
and we unite in one voice, sharing aloud the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
We come now to our time of communion, an ordinary meal made extraordinary by the love of Jesus. I invite you now to take out your elements. And as I bless them, I invite you to bless them with me. Pick them up when I pick them up. Thank God for them. You don't have to be perfect. You don't have to be a church member or in right standing. There is no right. God invites you to this table and wants you to come. Here is a place of love where we join together with one another, with all the saints, and with the presence of the Holy One. As Leonard Cohen once said, "Ring the bells that still can ring. Forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in." Come, beloved, to the feast.
God is with you. We come from the shadow and darkened corners, praising God. It is good to praise you, giver of life. From the depths of the waters of creation, you raised up land and life. You have heard the prayers of your people from out of the deep. You are the hope where none existed before, and every corner of your world you call good.
When the whole world seemed broken, you became love, wrapped in human form. Small and fragile, you set out to heal the world from the place of the broken ones.
And so we join the hymn of the ages, together with the voices of all who have gone before us.
Holy, holy, holy.
Holy are you, and holy is your child Jesus. He knew well the tears cried by the poor and the lonely. He touched the deep cracks in our world. He sat with the sick, ate with the hungry, and saw the sinners.
On the night in which he gave himself up for us, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread. And he gave it to his friends, saying, "Take and eat, all of you. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup. Again, he gave thanks to you, He shared it with his friends and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my life poured out for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, remember me."
And so, as we remember Jesus' sacrificial act of love, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Holy One, pour out your Spirit on us gathered here, even virtually across screens, and on these gifts of field and vine. Make them be for us the love of God made flesh, that we, together as a new creation and a new community around the globe, may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his act of sacrificial love. God, draw us close to one another, that we may be one as we share your love with the world.
Amen.
The Magi came bearing gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, each a symbol for what kind of king this might be. We know, too, that they received a gift that night. Of course they did, just as we each all received God's greatest gift. And so, let's take a moment to give thanks for the blessings in our lives that we have received. And in the same breath, as we give thanks for our blessings, we consider how we might be blessings to others. What intention do you plan to set for the week, or maybe the year, for how you will give to be a blessing for others, whether it is time, talent, or treasure? Gold, frankincense, or myrrh.
Mary had a baby, oh my. Mary had a baby, oh my. Mary had a baby, she laid him in a manger, glory in the highest, oh my. The angels told the shepherds, oh my. The angels told the shepherds, oh my. The angels told the shepherds about the little baby, glory in the highest, oh my. The star showed the wise men, oh my. The star showed the wise men, oh my. The star showed the wise men, the baby in the manger, glory in the highest, oh my. Gather round the manger, oh my. Gather round the manger, oh my, gather on the manger to see the baby Jesus, glory in the highest, oh my. Born to be our Savior, oh my, born to be our Savior, oh my, born to be our Savior, Jesus in the manger, glory in the highest, oh my,
oh my.
Thank you for joining us today. Our benediction this morning is a poem. It comes from the poet Jan Richardson. It's called Where the Map Begins. This is not any map you know. Forget longitude, forget latitude. Do not think of distances or of plotting the most direct route. Astrolabe, sextant, compass, these will not help you here. This is the map that begins with a star. This is the chart that starts with fire, with blazing, with an ancient light that has outlasted generations, empires, cultures, wars. Look starward once, then look away. Close your eyes and see how the map begins to blossom behind your lids, how it constellates, its lines stretching out from where you stand. You cannot see it all, cannot divine the way it will turn and spiral, cannot perceive how the road you walk will lead you finally inside, through the labyrinth of your own heart and belly and lungs. But step out, and you will know what the wise who traveled this path before you knew. The treasure in this map is buried not at journey's end, but at its beginning. Go, beloved, in peace.